Good morning, all of you. We are going to discuss the anatomy of female genital tract, the external genitalia, and we will also see this is all external genitalia. Then we will be also discussing about vagina. Now, the female external genitalia, which is also called as vulva or pudendum, so it includes the structures which are visible externally from symphysis pubis to the perineal body. Now, let us see the boundaries. Anteriorly, it is bounded by mons pubis. Laterally, it is bounded by thighs. And posteriorly, it is bounded by perineum. The vulva, that is the external genitalia of the female, includes the following parts. What are those? See, we will see mons pubis. The big labial folds are labia majora. The smaller ones are labia minora. This pointed structure which is present anteriorly is clitoris. Then this opening we have is the hymen. The overall this opening is actually called as vestibule. The openings inside the vestibule, we are finding the urethral openings. The other small openings we have are the openings of bulbourethral glands and also minor vestibular glands and paraurethral glands. We are going to discuss in detail like what are the openings anyhow when we discuss the vestibule. Now these are the like subdivisions of the vulva. Now let us discuss each part in detail. Like first of all we will discuss about mons pubis, so which is triangular mound of subcutaneous adipose connective tissue that covers the pubic bone. Here we will see after puberty the growth of curly hair on the mons pubis, which forms escutcheon. Hair is distributed in a triangle whose base covers the upper margin of the pubic symphysis and tip ends at the clitoris, like this. Now the labia majora. So the major like lip-like folds which are seen in the vulva or the labia majora, they are 7 to 8 centimeters in length, 2 to 3 centimeters in depth, 1 to 1.5 centimeters in thickness. They are continuous directly with mons pubis superiorly, posteriorly taper and merge into an area overlying perineal body to form posterior commissure. This is the point. The outer surface of the labia majora is covered with hair. Inner surface has abundant apocrine and acrine sweat and sebaceous glands, and it is hairless. The labia majora are covered by squamous epithelium. Beneath the skin, the dense connective tissue and adipose tissue are present, which are supplied by rich venous plexus. Nearly, it is void of muscular elements. Muscular elements are absent here. It is homologous with the scrotum in males. That is the labia majora. Now, the labia majora contains the termination of round ligament of uterus at its distal third and the obliterated processus vaginalis, canal of Knut. The round ligament can give rise to leiomyomas in this region. The obliterated processus vaginalis can be seen as dilated embryonic remnants in adults. During pregnancy, this vasculature commonly develops varicosities, where these veins may become highly tortuous, especially in parous women who have borne more children, from increased venous pressure created by advancing uterine weight. It may form hematoma if ruptured during childbirth. Now coming to the other structures below labia majora, we have labia minora. So labia minora, see this is the labia majora, inside we have the labia minora, which is a thin fold of tissue lying medial to each of the labia majora. Length is around 2 to 10 centimeters, width is 1.5 centimeters. It extends superiorly where each divides into two lamina. This is one and the other one is this. The lower pair fuses to form the frenulum, which is labeled here, this one is the frenulum of the clitoris, and the upper pair merges to form the prepuce, which is again labeled here for our convenience. Prepuce superiorly and frenulum inferiorly. The inferiorly extends to approach midline as lower ridges of tissue and diffuses to form the fossa like this. That means the inferior aspect of the labia minora continuation, we can see here it is diffusing to form the fossa, which is basically lacerated during childbirth. Now this is completely, we have the labial minus at the labia minora. So the superior lamellae is splitting and diffusing to form the prepuce, and inferiorly it is forming the frenula. The labia minora inferiorly it is forming the fossa. Structurally, the labia minora are composed of connective tissue with many vessels, elastin fibers, and some smooth muscle fibers. They are supplied with variety of nerve endings. There are many sebaceous glands, but they lack hair follicles. The lateral portion of the inner surface is covered by stratified squamous epithelium to a demarcating line, which is arc line, which we can see here. Medial to this line, each labium is covered by squamous epithelium, that is non-keratinized. Cutaneous structure lie on a connective tissue stratum that is loosely organized and thus permits mobility of skin during sexual intercourse, that is coitus. This loose attachment allows skin to be easily dissected off the underlying fascia during skinning vulvectomy, that is the removal of vulva in that area in case of any surgical procedures, like in case of cancers. It is homologous to the ventral aspect of the penis, that is the labia minora. Now coming to the next structure of the vulva, the external genitalia of female, that is clitoris. This principal female erogenous organ is located beneath the prepuce and above the urethra. This opening is urethra, above the urethra we are finding. It projects downwards between the branched extremities of labia minora. This is one and this is one labia minora. Superiorly, in between these two, it is projecting downwards. Okay, inwards towards the vaginal opening. The clitoris rarely exceed 2 centimeters in length, and it is composed of glands, a corpus or body, and 2 crurae. Glands, body, and 2 crurae. Okay, then. Now, coming to this glands or the clitorial hood, you will see it is usually 0.5 centimeters in diameter, and it is composed of spindle-shaped cells, and it is covered with stratified squamous epithelium that is richly innervated. The clitorial body contains 2 corpora cavernosa extending from the clitorial body. Each corpora cavernosa diverges laterally to form long narrow crurae. These lie along the inferior surface of the ischiopubic rami and deep to the ischiocavernosus muscle. Attached to the undersurface of the pubic symphysis, it is suspended by suspensory ligament. So this is the clitoris inside the body. These are the crurae, like these are the corpora cavernosa extensions. It is homologous to penis in males. So a clinical condition sometimes may exist, which is called as clitoromegaly, where you will see the length of clitoris may increase more than 3.5 centimeters and width may be more than 1 centimeter. Usually occurs in virilism due to excess androgens. Injury causes profuse bleeding and intense pain. Blood supply, it comes from the branches of internal pudendal artery. Clitorial body is supplied by deep artery of clitoris. Glands and prepuce, they are supplied by dorsal artery of clitoris. As I told you, we will be discussing the opening, that is vestibule. In adult women, it is almond-shaped area that is enclosed laterally by this arc line. External surface of hymen, this opening is hymen medially, and clitorial frenulum anteriorly and fossa posteriorly. Now, The vestibule, this opening inside the labia minor or whatever opening we have, is this area is actually vestibule, where we have around six openings. The two major openings which are usually discussed in many textbooks are the urethral opening and the vaginal opening. Apart from these, we also see the openings of the glands, like two Bartholin glands, and at times like two ducts of the largest paraurethral glands of Skinny, which you will be finding on either side of the urethral openings. The posterior portion of vestibule between the faucet and the vaginal opening is called fossa navicularis. As you can see here, it is labeled, this area is fossa navicularis, usually observed only in nulliparous women who didn't bear any children yet. This is fossa navicularis. Now, coming to the openings one by one, the major opening what we have is the urethra. Okay, urethral opening through which the urine is coming out. Okay, it is like continuing as from the urinary bladder in case of females. So, situated in front of the, see, this is the vaginal opening. In front of the vaginal opening, we are finding the urethral opening. It is 1 to 1.5 centimeters below the pubic arch. The paraurethral glands will be here, where I am showing you the arrow. We have better pictures also. Open on either on the posterior wall of the urethral orifice or directly into this vestibule. Now, the vaginal opening, see, this is hymen, or the vaginal opening, lies at the posterior end of the vestibule. The vaginal opening is rimmed distally by the hymen on its rim. This is the rim margins. It's composed mainly of elastic and collagenous connective tissue, and both outer and inner surfaces are covered by stratified squamous epithelium. In pregnant women, the epithelium of hymen is thick and the tissue is rich in glycogen. Changes produced in the hymen by childbirth are usually readily recognizable. Over time, hymen consists of several nodules of various sizes, also termed hymenal coruncles. Let us see the various types of hymens. See, if it is like this opening, the vaginal opening, that is hymen. If it is like a ring, you call it as annular hymen. Sometimes there may be a small tissue between this annular hymen when it is called a septate hymen. Sometimes it may be like a sieve, okay, that is cribriform hymen. Sometimes the hymen may be imperforate. And menstrual cycles, though it is starting, you will see they will not be visible until and unless you will see the very severe pain during menarche. And usually when the girl, young girl comes to us with severe pain in the lower abdomen, and when we check like in the scans, you will see the uterus will be filled with menstrual blood, but it will not be able to come out because there is no passage outside. In that condition, it is called as imperforate hymen. A small nick, such incision is given in this area and menstrual blood is collected outside. It's a very small procedure to do the to perform, like to bring the opening back in case of imperforate hymen. So Paris is like after childbirth, you see the size, like it becomes very much little big and very much irregular. It is Paris introitus. Now, coming to the vestibular glands, also called as Bartholin glands, termed greater vestibular glands, are the major glands. They measure 0.5 to 1 centimeter in diameter, yellowish white in color. They lie inferior to the vestibular bulbs and deep to the inferior end of the bulbocavernosus muscle. This is the bulbocavernosus on either side of the vaginal opening. This is bulbourethral glands. They are also opening in the vestibule. So their ducts are 1.5 to 2 centimeters long and open distal to the hymenal ring. This is the hymenal ring at 5 to 7 o'clock position on the vestibule at the junction of anterior two-thirds and posterior one-third. The duct is lined by columnar epithelium and stratified squamous epithelium near its tip opening. So the gland is compound racemose variety. It is homologous to bulbourethral gland of male, the Bartholin's gland. Now, during sexual excitement, The bartholin gland secretes abundant alkaline mucus, which helps in lubrication. Following trauma or infection, the bartholin glands either duct may swell or it may get obstructed to form a cyst, or sometimes because of infection, there may be pus formation, that is abscess. Apart from this, we also have minor vestibular glands, which are shallow glands lined with simple mucin secreting epithelium and open along the heart lung, which we have seen like this. Now, paraurethral glands are present on either side of the opening of the urethra. So, paraurethral glands of Schini, elective arborization of glands whose ducts open predominantly along the entire inferior aspect of urethra. The two largest are the Schini glands, and their ducts typically lie distal near the urethral meatus. This is the urethral opening and this is the distal part, and here you will see the opening of Schini glands. So inflammation and duct obstruction of any of the paraurethral glands can lead to urethral diverticulum formation. It is homologous to prostate in males. Now coming to the vestibular bulbs. These are almond-shaped aggregation of veins, 3 to 4 centimeters long, 1 or 2 centimeters wide, and 0.5 to 1 centimeters in thickness. It lies below bulbocavernosus muscle on either side of the vestibule in front of the bartholin glands. It is homologous to single bulb of penis and corpora spongiosa in male. It is likely to be injured during childbirth and may even rupture to create vulval hematoma. These are the veins. So coming to the blood supply of the external genitalia. So the branches of internal pudendal artery, the labial arteries, transverse perineal arteries, artery to the vestibular bulb, dorsal arteries to the clitoris, and branches of femoral artery, superficial and deep external pudendal arteries. You see, we don't know, like this is like we have the abdominal aorta, common iliacs, external iliac, and internal iliac. So internal iliac branches and femoral artery branches are giving blood supply to the vulva and also to the vagina. Coming to the venous drainage, goes to the internal pudendal vein, vesical or vaginal venous plexus, long saphenous vein. So suppose if these veins are becoming tortuous due to high pressure, as we usually see in case of like pregnancy, and it may rupture and spontaneously causing visible bleeding or hematoma. Coming to the nerve supply, bilateral spinal somatic nerves, anterior superior part is supplied by cutaneous branches from ilioinguinal and genital branch of genitofemoral nerves. The root value is L1, L2. Posterior inferior part is supplied by pudendal branch from posterior cutaneous nerve of the thigh. Root value is S1, S2 and S3. Between these two, vulva is supplied by labial and perineal branches of pudendal nerve. Again, the root value is S2, S3 and S4. We can see in this way, anteriorly ilioinguinal nerve and the genital branch of the genitofemoral nerve. And posteriorly, we can see the pudendal nerve and perineal branch of the pudendal and posterior cutaneous nerve of the thigh. After finishing the vulva or the external genitalia, now let us discuss about vagina. So, which is a copulatory organ in case of female. So it is distensible musculomembranous tube. It measures, like, the diameter is 2.5 centimeters and it communicates, length is around 15 centimeters. It communicates superiorly with the cervical canal and inferiorly it is communicating with vestibule of vagina. It serves as a passage for the menstrual blood. We know, like, this is the endometrium of the uterus. So endometrial glands will shed during menstrual cycle and through the vagina and through the vulval outlet, that is the hymen, you will see the menstrual blood will be coming out. And of course, during the delivery, you will see the baby is also passing through this vaginal outlet. It forms the inferior part of the birth canal. And of course, it is an organ of copulation, that is the sexual intercourse. Now coming, see, we have already studied uterus, isn't it? Where we have this fundus, body, cervix. The lower part of the continuation of the cervix is nothing but vagina. So this vagina, when you see in the sagittal section, it has the anterior wall, it has posterior wall. Anterior wall is measuring around 7 centimeters, posterior wall is 8.5 centimeters, and it has two lateral walls. Like these are the two lateral walls. And see, then it has like two folds, like which are formed due to the invagination of cervix. These are called as formices. So we have one anterior fornix. Behind will be, this is the anterior fornix, behind is the posterior fornix, and on either side we have lateral fornices. Now coming to the relations, now this is the female sagittal section of pelvis. Now let us get the orientation of this picture first. You have, this is the pubic symphysis. Behind the pubic symphysis we have urinary bladder. This is the neck of the urinary bladder, and this is the continuation urethra. What we have seen in the vestibule, one of the openings was the urethral opening. Behind the urinary bladder, we are finding the uterus, anti-verted and anti-flexed position. This is the cervix and this is the vagina. And we know we also have the vaginal opening, isn't it? That is the hymen. And behind, as we proceed, this is the rectum, and this opening is the anal canal. Now let us see, as we know now, this is the vagina. Let us see the relations. Now this is anterior part of this sagittal section. This is posterior part, which is clearly visible from the sacrum and coccyx bone. Anteriorly, pubic symphysis helps us to identify this is the anterior end. Now coming to the anterior relations, anteriorly, the vagina, it is related to the base of the urinary bladder, this one, and lower two-thirds of the urethra. Now coming to the posterior relations, so this is the posterior aspect. So we know, like, this is the pouch of Douglas, which is the peritoneal fold, which is seen between the almost cervix, vagina, and also the rectum. Okay, where we have the coils of small intestines. Middle one-third is related to the anterior rectal wall, and lower third is related to the perineal body. This is the perineal. This is completely vagina. You can see this is uterus, fundus, body, cervix. And this whole passage around 10 centimeters in length is the vagina. Laterally, the vagina is related to upper one-third to the pelvic tissue and fat. Middle one-third, we know the name of this muscle is levator ani. As we come down, we have the Bartholin's glands, which we have just seen when we were doing the vulva and the external genitalia and the vestibular bulb. Okay, and here on the either side, we are also finding the bulbocavernosus muscle. Coming to the blood supply, the blood supply is coming from the vaginal artery, okay, which is one of the branches of uterine artery. It also receives blood supply from the internal pudendal artery, which are the branches of internal iliac. Venous drainage, we can see the vaginal venous plexus and the uterine plexus of veins, which will be finally draining to the internal iliac, common iliac, and inferior vena cava. Coming to the lymphatic drainage, upper one third of the vagina is draining into internal and external iliac lymph nodes. Middle third, above the hymen, it is draining into internal iliac. Lower third, below the hymen, it is draining into superficial inguinal group of lymph nodes. Nerve supply, superior three-fourth and the uterus part, they are supplied by the utero-vaginal nerve plexus. Inferior one-fourth of the vagina is supplied by deep perineal nerve, which is a branch of pudendal nerve. Coming to the applied anatomy, because of the shortness and close proximity of urethra to vagina and anus, infection is likely and commonly spreading upwards to involve the urinary bladder. That means through the urethra, the infection from this passage. Through the urethra, the infection can easily spread to the urinary bladder, through the hymen opening, that is through the vulval outlet, that is the vaginal orifice, the infection can spread to the uterus as well. Because the anal canal is, the anal orifice is also very close, the infections can easily spread to the vagina, can also spread to the urethra. So that is because of the close proximity of vagina, urethra may get injured during childbirth. Paraurethral glands are the nothing but the skinniest glands which were very close to the urethra. We have seen these are the sites of infection, development of the benign tumor, that is adenoma, which may gradually transform into malignant tumor, this change is marker. Now coming to the other clinical aspects or the applied aspects, see during, we know like this is the like this is the vaginal opening through which the baby's head has to come out. Now the vaginal opening can be like we can widen the vulval outlet by means of a small surgical procedure which is generally done during normal labor, which is called as episiotomy. A surgically planned incision on the perineum and the posterior vaginal wall during second stage of labor. Most common obstetric operation performed during the normal labor in order to widen the vulval outlet so that the head of the baby can easily come out. So generally this is indicated in case where there is an elastic perineum causing arrest or delay in the descent of the head of the baby, the presenting part. Sometimes it may be breech also, where you will see buttocks or shoulder or anything can come. Anticipating perineal tear when the baby's like face is quite big, face presentation, breech delivery. Okay, normal delivery is the presentation is head. But in case if other than head, if the buttocks are coming or shoulder is coming or any other part of the baby other than head is coming, then you usually call it as breech delivery, shoulder dystocia. So operative delivery, forceps delivery, when the head of the baby is quite big and we are trying to deliver the baby with the help of forceps, by introducing forceps inside the vaginal outlet, we call it as forceps delivery or ventouse delivery. These are all assisted labors. In that cases also, it's always wise to increase the or widen the vulval outlet by means of episiotomy. So in case already if the lady has a history of previous perineal surgery, pelvic floor repair or perineal reconstruction surgery, we should not take any risk of any normal labor where the uterine contractions may come with high pressure and the perineum may rupture unevenly. To avoid the uneven rupture of perineum, we can always go for episiotomy, which will widen the pelvic outlet. Sorry, the perineal, that is the vulval outlet is widened and the head of the baby can be easily delivered. Now this is the procedure, like steps of episiotomy, the preliminary steps. Always we have to clean this vulval area with antiseptic. It is infiltrated, so we have to anesthetize this local anesthetic drug like lidocaine can be given, 10 ml of 1% solution. Then, see, this is the vulval outlet, head of the baby is very ready. You can see Bregma, Lambda, which are nothing but anterior and posterior frontally, head of the baby here. See, these are the directions. This is the vulval opening. You are just trying to cut it. Okay, not in the midline. If it is in the midline, then there is a chance of rupture of the, what is this opening? Anal orifice. So to avoid that, we have to go in direction which is oblique. Okay, so incision is made at a height of uterine contraction by curved or straight, blunt, pointed, sharp scissors. Thank you. Hope you understood.